All right, everyone, welcome back into this best of three between Columbia College and University of Chicago. My name is Joshua Fekes-Quest here with Brian, and game number one, it was quite the surprise. I'm sure to everyone watching as well as University of Chicago, they completely caught Columbia College off guard and took game one pretty decisively.
Yeah, I mean, they took me off guard with that stuff too.
Yeah,
like,
right.
Wow. Are you kidding me? That was a very impressive game. Very well done by University of Chicago. Pulling that out, we saw them flounder a little bit there in that early mid game, but they really started to pull it out as the game got closer and a little bit more tight.
I'm sorry, go on.
I was just gonna say, I was really impressed with their team fighting. They had a really good team fight composition that they used very, very well, and I think that definitely worked in their favor in playing against Columbia College.
Oh, no, definitely. I mean, they had a great team comp that I haven't seen this entire series. There used to be a big team comp of Protect the ADC, where you just have, you know, Janna, mid lane Lulu, and then, you know, even a Shen in the top lane, just a lot of shields on the ADC where they just pile them on and let the ADC just run wild. This time around, it was just shields for the entire team. You have Redemption. Yeah. You have Redemption, Lulu shields, Shen shields, Ivern shields. I'm probably missing somebody too. Not to mention you have Swain, who could shield, have the Zhonya's and just heal himself up. It was an incredible amount. Oh, and also Lock of the Iron Solari was thrown in there too, just for good measure.
Yeah.
There was a point where Gavar's health bar was only a half, but the entire other part of his health bar was all shield. In fact, the shield bar was more than his actual health bar, which was huge. There's so much protection on the side of the University of Chicago, and we're seeing the answer to that right now. As Columbia College, they take out both the Swain and the Ivern, and they stick with the Evelyn from the game number one to just try to counter that kind of comp that, you know, University of Chicago threw out in game number one.
Yeah, and University of Chicago is actually going to pick up Graves as the first pick. Last game, we did see Columbia ban away the Kha'Zix and the Rengar. I guess it was a little bit of a pocket pick for Rek, but he's actually opting to take the Graves instead of something that we may have seen him maybe be more comfortable on, or Columbia just didn't want to play against the Rengar Kha'Zix, and so they just banned it out because reasons. But no, the Graves does go over to University of Chicago. I can't really talk a whole lot about what type of team composition they want, because Graves is just, he's a pick that goes in any comp right now.
Oh, yeah, and he's so mobile. He's usually a big bully, but RJ was getting bullied pretty heavily by the friendliest creature of the jungle, Ivern.
Yeah.
We're not going to see that this time around, and we do see maybe a possible connection issue coming out here as we go back into the lobby. We're going to see, looks like the client crashed for the jungler. That has been happening a couple times. It even happened for the jungler of Columbia College in game number one, right in the beginning of the game. But we'll be back in just one moment. I believe Rek, he's going to get back into the game as soon as possible. But until he does, I suppose we just throw it over to music. So we'll be back in just a moment.
And with that, we are back into the game. They're just going to redo the picks and bans that we saw before. Sounds like the client was acting up a little bit. Hopefully those issues have been resolved by now. Pretty quick stuff coming out. We are going to see Graves is going to be the first pickup. And I believe we saw two picks coming out from Columbia College, but I can't actually remember exactly what they were.
I don't remember them being two picks. Actually, I think it was Graves, and then they were about to pick, and then the client dropped. But we do see what they are now. It was going to be an Ashe and a Lulu coming out. for the side of Columbia College. So they're already showing their bot lane, which is, you know, pretty interesting, giving that one away so early on. Now, we can see what University of Chicago want to do to play around that, as we saw the power of Lulu in last game. So they've taken away the Ivern, taken away the Swain, and now they've taken away the Lulu from University of Chicago. So completely throwing them off that big shield, I'm not gonna die comp in the first from the first game.
Yeah, and I think that's probably a composition that we're gonna start seeing a little bit more often now, as Lulu coming back into flavor again. She still is part of that kind of AP support and AP damage support, I guess, that we have been seeing recently. I say recently, but since like the end of season 6 and season 7 with the Zyra and the Karma, and then Janna coming out to kind of counter the Lulu shield a little bit.
Yeah, of course, Janna offers her own shield, not to mention a heal and a disengage from team fights. So that is going to be, fitting in very well with what they had in the first game. Of course, they go back to the Shin because he was such a presence in that first game too. Shin's been very popular lately as well. I've been seeing a lot of Shin coming out, and for good reason. There's really not much they've done to him. It's just the top lane meta has flowed in and out between Shin. You have Nautilus and Maokai in the top lane. Renekton had his glory days up there as well. Shin, he's always been kind of there, floating around. And sometimes, you know, if you get a team that works around Shin, or where a Shin thrives on, I should say, he is just one of the most dominant picks in that top lane. And not because he can dominate a top laner, but because he can dominate the entire map by split pushing and then staying united into his ally, and then going back to that split push with the teleport. He's an extraordinarily annoying champion to deal with. We're going to see if Columbia College have the answer for him. They think it's Renekton. Going to go back onto that one. RJ is a very prominent Elise player. Did play it against Minnesota last time we saw Columbia College on stream, where they actually destroyed Minnesota in 2 games. That was absolutely no problem for Columbia College. They're going to try to bring it to a game number 3, bringing out some of the strong picks. And this time, like I said, RJ going back on onto that Elise. But meanwhile, on the side of University of Chicago, we do have a Twitch being hovered over, and actually a Vladimir locked in. So that is going to be interesting as well. So going again with a sustained mid laner, Wee Baby Sheamus, he has a play style. He's sticking to it.
Yeah, and I think that actually is very interesting, right? Like, so if you look at the composition of Columbia right now, right, they have Ash, they have Renekton, they have Elise, they have Ahri, right? Like, these are champions that you can get good picks with, and it looks like we might have another another little bit of a support thing. Oh, hang on. It does look like we have a call out by the University of Chicago. That Ahri pick is actually supposed to be a Taliyah. So that is going to be switched up. We'll be hopping back in here very, very shortly. So even so, that still falls right in line with what I was talking about.
Right, yeah, and Taliyah's an interesting pickup too, because Hollywood actually plays Taliyah. We're gonna see if that one is going to affect him. You know, I mean, normally you play against a champion that you're pretty good with. You know the ins and outs of that champion. Taliyah was picked against Minnesota, as you know Hollywood played him against last game, or last time we saw him on stream. I mentioned that earlier, but this time it was with RJ. This time for Hollywood, he did played both LeBlanc and Taliyah. He did very well on both of them, but a little bit different a team they're going against. So we're getting back into pick and ban phase. We're gonna see these same picks, same bans here, except for that Ahri, who's going to be a Taliyah.
Yep. And I think something to note real fast is that the Ahri didn't get picked by accident. The Ahri was a placeholder. CC told Chicago that they were gonna pick Taliyah, but CC Dean doesn't own Taliyah. So that was just kind of what happened there. To clear that up real fast, I saw some questions about that in chat, and just to make sure everyone's on the same page with that. And I think Taliyah actually, in my opinion, works better with this composition more so than the Ahri does. Because of Taliyah's ult, she can basically form a wall wherever she wants. And so if you get picked away from your team, Ashe hits you with the crystalline arrow, and Taliyah just comes in right behind you and cuts you off from the rest of your team, you're forced to flash over that wall. I mean, there's only two champions on the side of Chicago have movement abilities, right? Shin has his taunt and Graves has his dash, but otherwise, if you're cut off from your team, if you're Janna, Twitch, or Vlad, like, you're kind of screwed, right?
Yeah, and not to mention, Taliyah also, with it all, can actually, you know, in a pseudo kind of way, it's not completely global, a good way of keeping up with Shin, if Shin, you know, if when once they get to, you know, the 20-minute mark, 25-minute mark, where they're a little bit more scattered, and Shin just happens to ult with Taliyah in the vicinity, but not quite there, Taliyah can actually come in with her ult as well. So, I mean, it's not a complete answer to a Shin ultimate, like, you know, say a Destiny would be from Twisted Fate, which even that's not even ultimate, you know, a complete answer to Shin's ultimate. It is a true global. They don't have too many of those left, but it is pretty close. So Taliyah, I do like that pickup. And like I said, Hollywood is comfortable on the Taliyah. Did very well against Minnesota last game. Knows the ins and outs of Taliyah. How it does against the Vladimir, that one's going to be a little bit more interesting. Taliyah does play very safe, doesn't let Vladimir get into the close quarters like he likes to. Get his transfusion on. We're going to see how that one plays out. But we do have the team comps here. Shin, Graves, Vladimir, Twitch, and Janna over on the side of University of Chicago. Renekton, Release, Taliyah, Ash, and Lulu on the side of Columbia College. Going with a slightly bit more of a pick comp over there. And the chat's any sort of... you know, sort of any sort of indication says that's what Columbia College excels at.
Yeah, and I think that's going to be really big. And one of the emerging and like the two storylines that I think are really the most important out of for this game right now is going to be how well is Hollywood on that Taliyah. Like you said that he played very well on it when we watched him before, but how well is he going to be able to play against Chicago, who did a very good job of team fighting very well, not getting picked out that much during that last game. And if this is what CC wants to do, I mean, if Chicago is able to play against it, then I think right. Columbia College is going to have a hard time. And then I think the other one to look at is Misty Stumpy on that Renekton in the top lane against Ghibli Studios. We saw Ghibli play very, very well on that Shin in the last game. His Stan Uniteds were very good. He was landing those taunts every single time on the targets that he needed to in those team fights to really help them go their way. And so I think those two matchups for me are the really big ones.
Right, and we're going to see how that plays out once we get onto the Rift. My name is Joshua FekesQuest, and I'm here with Brian. Going to give a quick shout-out to our sponsors, Band Gaming, Twitch.tv, and, of course, Azus. Also want to go ahead and point out we are hiring for a social media manager on for our social medias, of course. Head over to cstarleague.com for more information. Get your foot in the door of esports if that's something you want to pursue. CSL is a great place to start. Trust me, I started here, and I'm still here. Thank God I'm finally getting paid now, but you know, that's here or there. And we'll be back on the Rift in just a moment.
And with that, we are going to be loading into the game here for game number 2 versus University of Chicago and Columbia College. Currently, Columbia College is up in this, or I'm sorry, Chicago, University of Chicago is up 1-0 in the series against Columbia. Columbia did come in as the favorites, but now they're doing a little bit, falling a little bit behind there at the end of that last game.
Yeah, you kind of tripped up there because you didn't think you'd be saying that, but you are. University of Chicago, they pulled out all their might in game number one. That was fantastic team comp. And I do want to reiterate, I said this in the very beginning, this is probably the closest matchup in regards to seeds that we've seen, at least on broadcast. This is the number 4 seed, Columbia College, taking on the number 5 seed, University of Chicago. I mean, so University of Chicago, they're no pushover. They dropped one to Cincinnati last week, which I didn't think that would happen. But, you know, thank God my Cincinnati team did something. But University of Chicago, they weren't projected to do this well against Columbia College. Columbia, they want to bring this one back. They want to bring this into a game number 3. They're pulling out some of their more comfort picks right now. RJ on Elise, Hollywood on Talia. And, of course, Missy Stumpy on the Renekton. They're going to try to bring this one in. I feel like the spectator client has been so slow lately, but still loading in here.
Yeah, I know. I thought, like, this happened last time, too. Like, I queued us up, ready to go into the game, and then I got bamboozled. The spectator client bamboozled me once again. I can't seem to catch a break tonight with this spectator client, man.
No, it's been a little weird since the last patch. Not even the most recent patch, but the patch before that one, they kind of bugged it out a little bit. As you noticed last game, we weren't even in sync toward the end there, which, you know, is pretty unfortunate, but
it's all that's
right. That's been happening lately, and I should have suspected it, but I didn't actually pay attention to the chat I was supposed to, so I didn't sync up, so that's what happens sometimes. We'll see how it works out this time. As we get into the rift, first we have to get there, and apparently they're cleaning up the bodies from the first game still, so still loading in. But looking at these team comps, they took away quite a bit from the first comp of, I should say, Columbia College took quite a bit away from University of Chicago's first team comp. So, but they're still kind of have the same idea. Shields, heals, and transport. You got Shen, you have Vladimir, you have Janna. You essentially accomplished the exact same thing.
Yep. And I think that is a lot of similarities there, but I think the big deal for me is that Janna's a little bit harder to use that CC on than Lulu is. Lulu can just kind of be in the middle of a team fight, put her shield on someone and shoot the glitter lance out, like try to hit one or two people, and like it's pretty instantaneous. But with like Janna, you have to like charge up the tornado, like think about when to use it. You have to decide when you want to use your ultimate in comparison to like Lulu. Like The rapid growth is pretty easy to time. It's like, someone's about to die, rapid growth. Or someone's like in the middle of the enemy team, rapid growth, knock everyone up. You know, like, it's a little bit of a different, I think, play style between Janna and Lulu.
Yeah, no, definitely. If you can land the shields properly and, you know, charge up your tornado and have time to do all that and land it properly, Janna is a great force. But yeah, like you said, Lulu, a little bit more point and click instantaneous response. Well, it takes a little bit of foresight for the Janna, and that, I don't know. Obviously, you guys probably play League of Legends. 1.5 seconds is an eternity in this game. So that little wind up of the tornado can make all the difference. But we do see a line of scrimmage being drawn by Columbia College. This time, the same thing that happened last time. University of Chicago, they are grouping up. This time, we don't have Dean throwing out a karma cue.
Trying to bait them out a little bit. I don't know. I'm curious to see if University of Chicago decides to go and try to check this bush. Dean will have more knowledge of it than they will, and it looks like there is a pause time coming out.
Because why not?
That's right. Maybe there's maybe there's some more connection issues?
You never know. That's one thing about the college campuses. Sometimes they're shoddy. I think they have improved a lot since my day. I mean, I was in college, 10 years ago, 9 years ago, and I don't know, college campus internet, I would not have played competitive League of Legends on my college campus. I went to Northern Kentucky University, and it was a growing college, and they really emphasized toward my latter years of college on their informatics and technology centers, but man, when the time I got there, their internet was horrible. But course, Columbia College, they actually have their own facility. I actually don't know University of Chicago's status, what their facility looks like, if they have one, or what their support is. I should probably get somebody like them on the ULL Weekly, at least talk about them, because I've talked to Columbia College. I want more diversity now, especially with the University of Chicago showing up here, but we'll get to that another time. It's a cheap plug for my show. It just happens to be on Sundays at, you know, I mean, 7 Eastern time. But anyway, we are getting back into the game here, as it's like Columbia College and both Columbia College and University of Chicago starting on the bot side here. You're going to be meeting in the top side in a couple of minutes. So this is where I'm interested in seeing Brian in the mid lane. Hollywood versus Wee Baby Sheamus. And then more importantly, Taliyah versus Vlad. More importantly, I just like seeing these two because I don't get to see, I see Vlad every now and then. I don't ever get to see Taliyah. So I'm actually really interested in this mid lane. I saw how Hollywood played on her last time. I am anxious to see if Chicago allows him to play on her the way he played against Minnesota this time around.
Yeah, I think the Taliyah matchup is a little bit hard for me to cast because I personally don't see it very often. We don't see it super often in pro play. I don't see it a lot in the games that I play, so I'm not entirely sure what happens in this matchup. Obviously, Vlad can just walk up, get a free transfusion down like he does on every champion. But the games that I have seen of Taliyah is it really just boils down to like the skill of the Taliyah player, in my opinion.
Yeah, and like I said, Hollywood, one of the better Taliyah players, I'm sure. We're gonna see how that one pans out. Now in the bot lane, we do have a lot of poke coming out with volleys and glitter lances, not to mention help picks also from Columbia College's Dean. As we see the tank man taking up a little bit of that damage as the already chug a biscuit or eat a biscuit. You don't really chug biscuits unless you blenderize them.
Blenderize the biscuits.
We don't have any of those on the Rift. If anybody can, it would actually be Renekton. He has the closest to a giant blade that you can ask for right now.
That's true.
A lot of damage. Yeah, go on.
Oh, I was just gonna say, and he spins around like a blender.
Yeah, exactly. And he you know, slices and dices, quite literally.
Yeah.
Very nice.
we're on it today, man. Let me tell you.
So we see RJ actually, maybe not quite invading into Rex's jungle here. We actually just see him there. He goes. He's gonna go invade into it, but he is spotted out. He may be in a bad position here. He's spotted out by a ward. It looks like Hollywood may be coming over to join up with RJ, but RJ's just going deeper. And knowledge is power on the Rift. And University of Chicago, they have the knowledge, but they're not going to exercise their power right now. And in fact, Rek just took up the entirety of that topside jungle, gonna waste RJ's time and actually go steal some of RJ's minions here in the jungle. We might have a tower dive coming out in the top lane. We're gonna wait up here. RJ is waiting up in the brush. Misty Stumpy pushing up that wave, gonna wait for the minion aggro. He's spotted out. Studios knows this, knows it's gonna happen. Taunts RJ underneath the turret. And there is first blood going over to Misty Stumpy. Repel gonna keep RJ alive.
Yeah, very well done. Having RJ pick up the turret aggro on that first, so then that way he could pull it away from Mr. Stumpy. Stumpy could put down the damage. RJ could take two tower shots, burst out Shen, and then use the repel to get to safety, and bada bing, bada boom, you've got the first blood money.
Yeah, very nice. Very clean play. They tell Columbia College they've practiced that one. As RJ, like I said, a prominent Elise player, knows the in and outs of that play, of that champion, knows what he can do with it. Very nicely executed by Columbia College. But now in the mid lane, Hollywood going a little bit of the side here. Very low on mana, spamming it out onto Wee Baby Sheamus, who doesn't have mana, actually. Doesn't have to worry about that one. Can sustain himself for quite a long time. Actually has been forced to use his one pot in the mid lane. So you only get one with the Doran's shield. Kavar going into stealth mode. See if he's gonna try to stealth into somebody here. One poke on Artemis and it is done, he is back.
Dude, sometimes you just have to use like one single burst of poison to assert your dominance in the lane.
Yeah, that's essentially all it was. I don't know how much dominance it got, but it was a very valiant effort by Kavar. Coincidentally, Twitch is being played this game. A little bit of a mix-up in the last game with Twitch and Caitlyn, but this time Kavar is going to be playing the Twitch. You think he might be very comfortable on that one. See, wanted it last game, did not happen.
Yeah,
but did quite well with the Caitlyn.
Yeah, he did. He did play very well on the Caitlyn. He used it very well in the comp that they had there. Something that we didn't really talk about that much is the power of the Twitch Janna. So Janna can actually, while Twitch is in stealth mode, she can lay down that shield, which does give protection, and it also increases the AD of the person that the shield is on. So while Twitch is in stealth, he can receive that shield, set himself up in a perfect position, and then he can use that rat tab. But here comes Ghibli Studio. He is going to get ganked and pretty much die before I can pass it over to you for a play-by-play.
That is very true, because a flash was actually used by Misty Stumpy. So much aggression in that top lane. Knew exactly how much he could do onto Ghibli Studios and took him down. Two kills over Ghibli Studios in that top lane. Having a lot more rough time than he did in game number one.
Yeah, and Mr. Stumpy is doing a really good job on the connection.
Yeah, fantastic. And he might be doing another job here, another tower dive, and another successful gank and kill by Columbia College. They are just so smooth, so clean in that top lane, and took out the teleport of Studios.
Yeah, I mean...
Oh, wait, it was already down. Never mind, he was just back up there.
Yeah, he walked back up, showed up, and then there he was. Like, there goes the first turret at 7 minutes and 45 seconds. That is extremely fast. We are seeing what I would say is a completely different Columbia College this game than we saw last game.
Yeah, and as we did mention, the spectator client is a little wonky. I was off once again, but I am back at it. Thank you for pointing out that timestamp. Oh, so subtly. And we are back in this game together, synced as one. As the first turret of the game does go down over to Columbia College, they pick up that first turret gold. They may be able to pick up the second turret as well in the bot lane. May have to wait one more wave, or they could just force it out here. Artemis is going to just force that one down, take a turret shot of, on himself, but that is two turrets in favor of Columbia College. And they get a huge gold spike before the 10-minute mark here.
Yeah, I mean, that's very, very big for Columbia College, right? They are 4K gold up right now. Renekton already has Black Cleaver at 8.5 minutes. He is disgusting. Like, Shin only has that 15 armor coming from that cloth armor. And Renekton's going to be able to shred right through that. That's going to provide so much freedom for him to do whatever he wants in that top lane against Ghibli Studios. And that basically means that if Ghibli Studios goes ahead and uses that Stand United to get somewhere else on the map to help protect the teammate, if Misty Stumpy decides to not follow using his own teleport, he's going to have a lot of pressure to put down onto these turrets, and Chicago's just not going to really be able to answer him.
Yeah, this is a completely different game number one. As Columbia College, they have the top lane figured out of Chicago. Knows how to counter that very dominant Shin in game number one. I won't say he was absolutely pivotal in team fights, but he was very important. I mean, there were just so many things going into those team fights from Chicago in game number one that it's hard to call one member pivotal. But taking one member out is not going to be a bad thing ever, and that is exactly what Columbia College has done. They've delayed Studio's map pressure, delayed his effectiveness in this game, and that is only going to help out Columbia College, as the first dragon was picked up already by Columbia College 2, again with the first two turrets, Ocean Drake going over to them, and it's going to be huge. They're already, like I said, night and day from game number one.
Yeah. And I think something else that is completely different is the way this bot lane is going. Like, before we saw Kavar and Tankman, like, be very, very strong in that bot lane, but now they're actually falling behind Artemis and Dean. And I think that is going to be huge, because Artemis, as we kind of heard talk about with his Sivir, ideally, he would have gotten going a lot sooner last game and been a lot more dominant. But now he has that opportunity with this Ashe being about 28 CS ahead, which equates to roughly a kill at this point. And so we do kind of see that advantage in the Caulfield Hammer compared to just the attack speed item coming out of Twitch.
Yeah, and Essence Reaver is a big item for Artemis. And yeah, you get that power spike very early that way. And of course, crit is never a bad thing for an Ashe. Helps her auto attacks very much, as she always crits. But as we were talking about that, the Rift Herald was actually taken, which I've heard being called a luxury buff. And I mean, that is a very appropriate term right now. As like I said, the Columbia College, they are in control right now. They have the advantage in the top lane. Why not take that, Enchanted Crystalline Arrow, not gonna hit, but why not take that luxury buff? Yeah. They always want to pause for those just in case, but why not take that luxury buff? Because they can't afford it right now. There were no objectives, other objectives to take. And yeah, the farm game is all in favor of Columbia College. So yeah, they deserve that. They earned that that Rift Herald. They got the last outer turret of the game, and they are accelerating this game into the mid game as fast as possible for themselves, accelerating their gold lead from 16.2 against 16.2k. They have 21.3k on their favor now.
Yeah, I mean, that's crazy. Like, about 12 minutes and 15 seconds, they're up by 5k gold, 3 towers, they have a Drake, and you said they picked up the Rift Herald already, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't see it go down, and I heard you talking about it, so I wanted to make sure. Yeah, okay, I see. Renekton has the Rift Herald buff,
and he's gonna use it. Yeah, he's gonna pop his Dominus and use that Rift Herald buff, as it does help you when you're isolated against enemies, so... Misty Stumpy, he is attracting 4 members of University of Chicago in the top lane, picking up a double kill, getting out of there, flashing out. Massive play by Misty Stumpy.
I'm just like, that is the power of the 3-0 Renekton going against a Graves who's not that farmed up yet, only has the Warrior's enchantment, and just the ability for him to chase down that Shen just gave him so much power. That's 2 kills and 2 members less on the map for Chicago, and that gives so much availability for Columbia to set down some deep wards, to get their presence into the enemy jungle, and just apply some dominance. And that's huge, because since it's so early in the game, they're already pushing in on these tier 2 turrets, and having that vision is pivotal to making sure that you don't blow a lead that you spent like the first 15 minutes of the game getting.
Yeah, Columbia College, they would not want to do that whatsoever. Hold on, looks like Wee Baby Sheamus may be getting caught out here. He has a Sanguine Pool. Hold on, oh my gosh, RJ gets chucked down, but he stays alive. Just barely wrecked, barely staying alive as well. Stan United coming out along with the Monsoon from Tank Man to keep everyone alive. But now the big powerhouse, Misty Stumpy, he teleported in. He gets exhausted, but that means that Hollywood's not exhausted. He takes down Wreck in the end. And that is a 1-0 in favor of Columbia College. They are looking for more, though, as Studious, he's going to go down in a moment here. And yeah, there's another kill. Double kill for Dean the Lulu, actually, as that is now a 4-0 in favor of Columbia College. And they are just running away with this game. I don't know where this team was in game number one, but this is what they needed to show up with in game number one. At least they did it sometime. Because they are just running away. It's not even 15 minutes and they're gonna get an inhibitor now.
Yeah, this is the Columbia College that I have been hearing rumors about. Definitely not the one that showed up last game. Hollywood is playing disgusting on that Taliyah. Like, he is putting everything where it needs to go to catch out players. He single-handedly zoned off Wee Baby Sheamus that entire fight. Just kept him in the back line. He wasn't able to get in there at all. And we did see that pretty much everyone on the side of Chicago wasn't able to get into the fight. Like if they were in the fight, they were dying. I mean, Columbia is so far ahead right now. I mean, almost 10k gold at 15 minutes. That's a lot. That's a really, really large deficit. And if I'm Chicago, I'm really trying to figure out how you're just able to maintain just this deficit and not let it grow.
Yeah, and that's exactly what it is. Keeping the advancement of such a snowball, it's so hard. And sometimes you just have to think about the next game, which it is a best of three. Chicago won the first game. They give themselves that little bit of leeway where they can think about game number three. So, I mean, at this point, maybe that's what they're doing. It's not over yet. It's only 15 minutes in. We're talking like it's the complete end, but obviously, whenever you see an inhibitor down already, 2 drakes, you know, 5 turrets, you kind of start thinking of it that way. Pick missing on the wreck, as I was talking there, the cocoon not quite landing, but that is going to drive back 2 members of University of Chicago. into their own base, and that is going to prompt Columbia College to wait for this wave and possibly just force down this inner top lane turret. There's the Enchanted Crystalline. Oh my god, okay, well, Enchanted Crystalline arrow onto Wreck, and he got wrecked because his health bar completely disappeared. Hollywood picking up that kill very, very easily.
I figured out Columbia College's strats. They shoot Crystalline Arrow and then they press the delete key.
Oh yes, that seems to be working for them. that's the strategy. Don't stop it because it's working. 0-10 right now. They have deleted 10 members. They have hit the, and here is that ultimate coming out from Hollywood, drawing up that big, big wall with Weaver's Wall. But now we might have a good fight coming on our hands for, for University of Chicago, but I don't think that's gonna happen. RJ finally does go down, but Missy Stumpy is just so massive. My God, he was destroying everybody with that wild growth, spinning around and doing the AoE damage from the Dominus. There's a triple kill going over to Hollywood, and now there's going to be a lot of damage going on to those turrets. Not quite enough in the minion waves coming in from the bot lane, but they are going to be able to pick up this top lane inhibitor. And that's two inhibitors down in under 20 minutes. Oh, hold on, they're not gonna pick that one up, I lied, never mind.
You got too excited.
I did. Hold on. Dean.
Maybe all right. Trying to sneak through these turrets.
Yeah, don't go through that one.
Do it. Oh.
Poor Dean. That was a shutdown. That actually was a shutdown, so a little bit of extra gold going over to University of Chicago.
Oh boy.
Pick a win is a win, whatever.
Yeah, I think it was a miniature shutdown, so I believe each member of the side of Chicago got, I think it's like 15, 20 gold, something like that, with a miniature shutdown on two kills. Yeah. I remember when they implemented that back in, I think it was like season like six sometime, they changed how like the killing spree system works, and like two kills was a shutdown for me, and I was like, that is so confusing, because you're going from like two kills being a shutdown, or like, I think it was like five kills being a shutdown to like two.
Right, yeah, it's a very low amount of gold, but it is still something.
Yeah. And I think that was like one of the things that they tried to help with, like the come from behind mechanics, right? Like,
yeah,
help you stay in the game a little bit if you get a big kill down, get a little bit of extra gold for everyone.
We're gonna see if it helps out at University of Chicago. They got two of them. Actually, no, they only got one, as RJ did not technically have a killing spree. I think you still get kind of a shutdown for a lot of assists. But speaking of RJ, he might be in a bad situation, but nah, he's not. Hollywood's there. He's gonna protect him. And Missy Stumpy is going to finish off the little rat from, I think it's from Zahn. I actually don't remember anymore. We'll talk about that later. Wreck, he is going to throw everything he can at Missy Stumpy, who is not going to die. My God! Missy Stumpy is a monster on this Renekton. It is so impressive watching him play this.
Yeah.
And there's a double kill as he finishes off Studios, I should say, and that is going to be game number two in this best of three, going over to Columbia College, bringing us to a game number three. That was under 20 minutes. Where was this Columbia College in game number one, Brian?
I don't know. Maybe it was just the team comp. They were like tried to do something new with the team comp they had last game, or I honestly don't know. Like, the problem is it wasn't just a completely different Columbia College. This felt like a completely different University of Chicago as well. Like,
that's definitely true too. They did not shine near as much as they did in game number one. And you were talking about, they had a little bit of a rough start in the first game. It wasn't like an extraordinary rough start, but it wasn't this bad of a start. It wasn't this rough of a start as in this game. And they still prevailed in game number one quite heavily. But Columbia College didn't even give them a chance in this game.
Yeah, there was no chance for really anyone to breathe. I mean, like, after Misty Stumpy got those first two kills in the top lane, it was pretty much over from there. I mean, I think it was, 8.5 minutes when I said that Renekton got his Black Cleaver? 3-0?
Yeah, something like that. He dominated very quickly.
Yeah, and that was just, I mean, I don't really know a whole lot to say about that. Luckily, I don't really have to talk that much about it, considering that we are going to game number three of this series.
Yes, we are.
So that gives us a little bit of an opportunity to compare game. Like, we've seen what Chicago can do. We've seen what Columbia can do. So now it makes me wonder, now that both teams have kind of adjusted to their best, how are they going to make that happen for game number three?
It is going to be interesting. I'm very interested. My name is Joshua Fekas Quest. We have to get there first. I'm here with Brian. So stick around. We're going to get this next lobby set up, get ready for pick and ban, because it's going to be an interesting one, see how the teams adapt here, because it's in the game, game number three, in a best of three between Columbia College University and, of course, Chicago University of Chicago, I should say. Winner of this one goes on to take Robert Morris University. Stick around. We'll be back in just a moment.